That was excellent. Well, welcome to all of you this beautiful Sunday morning and to our guests. We here at Baker Memorial United Methodist Church are an open and reconciling church where differences are welcomed and respected. We greet you on this beautiful Sunday morning with a couple of announcements. And for those of you who are visiting and don't know, we have announcement sheets now. As you come into the sanctuary on both ends, we ask you to pick one up because it talks about all the exciting ministries, outreach events, various ways we are collaborating with God's Spirit in the world. We have a couple things to lift up. Oh, I didn't even introduce myself. Well, I am Reverend Becky Neighbor.
Probably why you can't hear me, because I didn't have the mic on. Let's see if it's on. Am I on? Oh, there we go. Now you can hear me. I'm Reverend Dr. John Lozer. It is a great privilege and honor to be with you this morning in worship. A couple of things for this week that I want to lift up to you. If you came in the same entrance, you may have noticed the big bulletin board, and there's some boxes underneath it. That's for collecting school supplies. This is what the Hands and Hearts folks are doing for Fish, our local food pantry in East Aurora. Today is the last Sunday for collections, but we can take additional items down to the food pantry by Tuesday. So if you have not brought in a donation and you would like to, bring it to the office either tomorrow or Tuesday morning, and I'll make sure it gets down there. Also, on Tuesday evening in the chapel, we have our monthly prayer meeting at 7 p.m. This is open for anybody who wishes to pray in a group. We use the hymnal to spend time both singing and praying, so all are welcome.
I'll just take the liberty to also announce, along with all the school supplies, that the Hands and Hearts group, that is the women's group, it's a United Methodist Women's Social and Action Group. They will be meeting at 7 o'clock at Wendy's house. Wendy, can you raise your hand? That's Wendy's house. So if you don't know how to get there and you'd like to attend, all women are welcome. I also want to highlight our RIDE ministry, Reach, Include, Disciple, and Engage. This is our millennial ministry that we are starting up for singles, couples, and young couples with families. Two things regarding that. One is, you saw the envelopes on your way into the sanctuary. We are doing a fundraiser. You take an envelope, you write a check for it, fill it for RIDE, write Baker Memorial UMC on it, Attention RIDE Ministries. We need to fund this ministry. This is indicative of what the Spirit is calling us to do in terms of reaching out and growing this church and making disciples. Young family, young single, young couple disciples. So we would encourage you to take an envelope. We are halfway to our goal of $5,000. So for those of you online with us in internet land, you can sponsor any amount. I think they run from $1 to $100.
Yeah, I think the lows and the highs are gone, so the ones in the middle are still left over on the tables.
So we'd appreciate any donation you can make to this new and exciting ministry. Also for RIDE, our launch event is going to be August 27th. It's a Friday night. It's trivia night. We've invited all the people who we've made connections with, and we need help. We need help serving. We need help cleaning. We need help setting up. So if you can donate some of your time to that, please let myself or Lisa or Pastor John know. Wow, that was a lot.
All right. Now I want to start something new this morning. I'm going to read one devotion from the upper room that I believe fits the theme of the service this morning. So if you don't know what the upper room is, this is a daily devotional booklet that we have in the same entrance and down by the office that you are welcome to take these home. Here's the devotion. This is from Thursday, this past Thursday. The scripture reading is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, God's good, pleasing, and perfect will. And then there's a small devotion which is written by a regular person, not a theologian, okay? Here's what it says, and this one's from Mantra Weaver from Texas. The alarm of a nearby water system woke me up. After several minutes, I heard a mockingbird copying the beeping sound. I smiled at the bird who was copying not another bird's song, but a noise from a machine made by humans. Then I thought about what I copy. How often do I, as a child of God, imitate humanity's way rather than God's way? My amusement faded as I realized that just that week, I had imitated the habits of the world more than once. I was quick to judge a woman's character based on her clothing. I held a conversation questioning the motives behind someone's acts of service. My TV shows, reading, and music that week had not portrayed godly values. In today's reading, Paul encourages us to imitate God's love. But too often, rather than looking on others with the kind of love God shows me, I think and act out of habits and judgments that I have learned from the world around me. Maybe that is why Paul says that we should follow Christ's example of a life filled with sacrificial love. As we seek to imitate Christ, God can transform our attitudes so that we can grow and act in ways that match God's will for us. And then there's a brief prayer. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for the example of Christ's sacrificial love. Help us to imitate God's love in our attitudes and actions. Amen. Let's continue to be in prayer as we hear the prelude this morning.
Thank you.
Would you join me in our call to worship? Blow the trumpet. Consecrate yourselves and call a sacred assembly. Gather the people and sanctify the congregation.
The Lord will answer and say to us, "Behold, I will send you grain, new wine, and oil, and you will be satisfied."
Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done marvelous things.
We will be glad and rejoice in the Lord our God. Praise
the Lord. And would you stand as you are willing and able, and let us sing our opening hymn, which is number 158 in the hymnals. Come, Christians, join to sing. And if you are going to sing and you have your masks, please put them on.
For God's will for you is to be holy and happy. So won't you celebrate by giving one another a holy wave? Our first reading this morning comes to us from the book of Leviticus, chapter 20, verses 7 through 8 from the New King James Version. Hear these words of our Lord. Consecrate yourselves, therefore, and be holy, for I am the Lord your God, and you shall keep my statutes and perform them. I am the Lord who sanctifies you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us stand for our next song of worship as you are able.
Mm-hmm. holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, to yours, oh Lord. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for. Faithfulness is what I need. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what you want from me. Take my heart and form it. Take my transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, oh Lord. Righteousness, righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to your. Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need.
Amen. Please be seated. Now is the time of the service when we have our call to offering. As we listen to the offering song, you are welcome, if you feel so moved, to come forward and put your offering in the plates in the front. And also during this time, consider how and what you might offer of yourself to God this week. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
This morning's offertory is participatory. I have spent the last week and a half and the next week at a summer camp, so it will not be a surprise what's on my mind, which is a kid's song. I'm pretty sure most of you know this. It's Rejoice in the Lord Always. So we're going to sing it through once, and then we're going to divvy you up and do it in a round, because that's what you do at a kid's camp. So sing along with me. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Again, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Now, this side of the church will sing along with me, and the other side of the church, you're on your own, but you got to come through partway through it, or got to come in partway through it. Probably some of you have done this before, know where to come in. If not, we'll just try singing it through a couple times, see what happens, let the spirit leave, and as the words say, rejoice. Ready? One, two, three, four. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, 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 and again I say rejoice. Good job.
Thank you, Lord, for sustaining us with hope and with joy by your presence that is always working within us. Lord, keep us mindful of your call for us to be holy, to be peculiarly different, radically different in this world in the ways we love. And Lord, we ask you to bless the gifts we have brought forward, that with them, they just may be a mere glimpse of the overwhelming joy we have in your Son, our Savior and our Redeemer, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Please be seated.
Good that I brought my glasses up, I guess. Okay. Excuse us. The New Testament reading this morning is from Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 24. Thank you. Brothers and sisters, we ask you to respect those who are working with you, leading you, and instructing you. Think of them highly with love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. Brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those who are disorderly. Comfort the discouraged, help the weak. Be patient with everyone. Make sure no one repays a wrong with a wrong, but always pursue the good for each other and everyone else. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in every situation because this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Don't suppress the Spirit. Don't brush off Spirit-inspired messages, but examine everything carefully and hang on to what is good. Avoid every kind of evil. Now, may the God of peace himself cause you to be completely dedicated to him. And may your spirit, soul, and body be kept intact and blameless at our Lord Jesus Christ's coming. The one who is calling you is faithful and will do this. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Today's reading comes from the book of John, chapter 17, verses 13 through 19. And this is in the New King James Version. This is Jesus speaking to God. Father, now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that my disciples may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the word and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. This is the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. So I picked these passages of Scripture because each one of them speaks of God being the one that sanctifies us as Christ's followers. That's exactly what that passage in Leviticus says. I am the Lord who sanctifies you. What does it mean to be sanctified? We're going to get to that. This is another in my sermon series where I speak on what I believe and why I believe it. The Thessalonians reading that Mimi read for us gives us an idea of how we are sanctified and how we act and live our lives as we are sanctified. Paul says, comfort the discouraged, help the weak, be patient with everyone. How many of you have trouble with being patient with everyone? Probably a bunch of you. But Paul says, be patient with everyone. If we have trouble with that, we need God's help. And we can call on God to help us do that at any moment of any day. He also says, no one repays wrong with a wrong, but always pursue the good for each other and for everyone else. And then he says, rejoice always. I love that, doing the round for our doxology. Before we did the doxology, I always enjoyed doing that when I was in the camps back 5, 6, 7 years ago. I was able to be not a counselor, but a chaplain in a camp, and that was one of the rounds that we did. Rejoice always. Pray continually. What does that mean, pray continually? I believe that just simply means have God in our minds all the time, and when we need to speak to God, God's right there. We just speak to God. Give thanks in every situation. What is it today that we can look at in our lives that we can give God thanks for? And don't suppress the Spirit. What does that really mean? Well, we've got the Spirit living within us, right? We don't want to suppress the Spirit by not following God's will for our lives, doing something that becomes sin for us. That's how we don't suppress the Spirit. And if we need God's help, the Spirit's right here to help us. Help me, Lord, do these things that Paul says. And then it says, don't brush off Spirit-inspired messages, but examine everything carefully. Now I'll give you a brief example from yesterday morning. I'm painting the front and sides of my garage. Sounds kind of strange that God would be involved in something like that, right? But I actually had to take the downspouts off the garage, not only because they needed to be cleaned out, but they needed to be readjusted and then repainted. Well, one of the straps on one of the things broke. This happened on Friday. I'm not supposed to work on Friday, so please don't tell anybody. but I actually did this on Friday. So Saturday morning, when I went to put the downspouts back up, before I even got out of bed, God put a box in my head, the picture of a box, because I knew that there were straps in a box somewhere in my house for this downspout. So I got up and I got dressed and I went downstairs and I said, Lord, show me where the box is. So at first I went down in the basement and I looked around on the shelves in the basement and I found it. Within 2 minutes, I found the box because I had the picture, the image in my mind. I, of course, had seen the box before, but it was the Spirit that brought the image back to my mind so that I could find it quickly. Don't suppress the Spirit. Don't think, ah, that's nothing. Go with it. See where God leads. And then John, in the book of John, Jesus is praying to his Father in heaven, asking that his disciples would be sanctified by the truth of God, which is found in the Scriptures. Jesus is asking God to sanctify us. So what does it really mean to be sanctified? Well, think about the word consecrate. That's something that we do when we have communion. We consecrate the elements. What does it mean to be consecrated? It means to be set apart, to be treated as sacred, to be hallowed or holy, or for us to keep ourselves apart or separate, separate from being involved in all of those worldly things that Paul says don't be involved in, that Christ says don't be involved in. Perhaps you've never thought of yourself as being sacred and holy, but if the Holy Spirit is really living inside of us, then we are holy vessels of God. Now, this may seem difficult for us to live as holy and set apart from others who do not follow Jesus. That doesn't mean never be around them. Don't mistake my words here. We are around people who don't follow Jesus all the time, and we need to be around them, especially those that we know and love who are not following Jesus. It is actually impossible for us to not be around these people. But it is also impossible for us to be holy without seeking the help of the Holy Spirit to be so. When we refuse to engage in activities that defy God's covenant, ungodly activities that Jesus tells us to avoid, and those activities that unbelievers participate in, we are setting ourselves apart as God's people. We are consecrating ourselves to God. For some of us, this may be difficult. But as we choose to live as Christ taught us to live, repeatedly asking for Holy Spirit power to do so, holy living becomes more natural for us. This is God's sanctifying grace working within us, transforming us a little bit at a time, each and every day, to become more like Jesus Christ. Now, I'll give you another short example. Two Fridays ago, I had gone to Target to buy my mother a toaster. She needed something that was easier for her to move with her hand because she has so much pain in her arms at this point. And she was using a toaster oven that had a dial that was very hard to turn. So I went and I got her a toaster. So in the parking lot, as I'm getting out of my car, I saw this guy walking through the parking lot. Looked like he was kind of scruffy, maybe not had a bath in a long time, I don't know. But my first thought, which I've shared with you, some of my first thoughts that happened, some of those judgmental ones, I was able to immediately suppress it. And I thought, because he went to somebody else and asked them for something to eat or some money, I thought, okay, because I'm walking along, he's going to ask me. Well, sure enough, he did. He saw me, he asked me, and I said, okay, would you like something to eat? Come in the store with me, I'll buy you something to eat. Okay, so he followed me in the store, where there's a coffee shop in Target. I bought him breakfast, I bought him something to drink, and I bought him something that he could take for later. Because I felt that that was the right thing to do, to share what I have been blessed with by God with someone else who has not been so blessed. He did share with me that he is homeless currently, so he was in need of something. And fortunately, I was there to provide something. I did so because I felt the Holy Spirit leading me to do it. Now, in the past, when I was much younger, and I've shared with you some of the things that I did when I was much younger, I probably would have just brushed him off. I don't do that anymore because I sense God working in me to help someone else. Now, last week, in my message, I talked about being born anew, or born by the Holy Spirit, as a regeneration of our human spirits. This is the beginning of God's work of sanctification in our lives. To be born again, or born anew, is the first step in becoming a new person through receiving Jesus as Savior and Lord. This is when we are justified or made right with God, and our spiritual birth takes place. More importantly, it begins the process of being sanctified. Paul wrote, "I pray that God, who gives peace, will make you completely holy, and may your spirit, soul, and body be kept healthy and faultless until our Lord Jesus Christ returns." Now, I prayed a prayer similar to that this morning as I was getting ready for the day for all of you. Because God is the one that sanctifies us. God is the one that makes us holy or set apart. It is God's grace working in our lives as we cooperate with God through our devotion that sanctifies us. To sanctify is to set apart, to consecrate, to make holy for a sacred purpose. In the United Methodist Church, we have a statement in our Book of Discipline that is brought over from the Confession of Faith of the Evangelical United Brethren Church that we were joined with in 1968. Part of that statement on sanctification says this: "We believe sanctification is the work of God's grace through the Word and the Spirit, by which those who have been born again are cleansed from sin in their thoughts, words, and deeds, and are enabled to live in accordance with God's will, and to strive for holiness, without which no one will see the Lord." Sanctification is the lifelong process of being renewed and transformed into the likeness and mindset of Jesus Christ. This is what God expects of those who follow Jesus. He is the ultimate role model for all people to exemplify. As a human, Jesus perfectly obeyed all of God's laws and commandments. In doing so, Jesus fulfilled the entire law, and he teaches us to do the same by living out the two greatest commandments, loving God and loving neighbor. Jesus teaches us that when we daily practice these two commandments, we are enabled to follow the whole law of God. However, all people are poorly equipped to live out this kind of love towards God and towards others without seeking Holy Spirit empowerment each and every day to do so. I'll give you another brief example. This is from further back in my life. When I was working at Kenmore as a building superintendent, I used to talk to folks quite often using sarcasm, and it was really quite a negative way of using sarcasm, because there was just a bunch of things that were just bothering me about the world. They still do bother me about the world, but I don't let them bother me to the point of being negative. The Holy Spirit working in me has worked out some of that negativity. He's still working out more of it. He's working on it all the time, but the Holy Spirit is working on it. And so that sarcasm doesn't come out of me hardly ever anymore, at least not in the face of other people. Sometimes maybe in private. But again, the Holy Spirit is working on me continually. It is through the power and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, who helps us to understand and live out God's covenant as explained to us in the Scriptures. Sanctification is a process. It's a process. It goes on throughout our lives of us cooperating with the work of the Holy Spirit, who transforms our lives moment by moment to become more aligned with God's perfect will through the renewal of our minds and our hearts. Sanctification is the lifelong progression towards becoming mature disciples of Jesus Christ. And we ought to be increasingly have in our lives the evidence of that transformation that others and ourselves can see. All of us who claim to be Christ's disciples, who claim Christ as Lord and Savior, ought to be able to see these fruits of the Spirit becoming more and more evident in our lives. Do you display evidence of God's sanctifying grace in your life so that you and others can take note of it? If so, this is the evidence of God's sanctifying grace working in your life to transform your mind and your heart to be more aligned with God's perfect will revealed to us in the Scriptures. This should be the goal of everyone who calls themselves Christian. Lord Jesus Christ, thank you for showing us by your life how to live a life that pleases God. Where we fall short, Lord, I pray, open us to the work of your transforming grace. In the name of Christ, I pray. Amen. And would you stand as you are willing and able and sing with me our response hymn, Take Time to Be Holy, number 395 in the hymn.
Thank you.
Let us now prepare our hearts and our minds to lift up all the things that we have on them, our joys, our concerns, our care for those around us and in this world. Lord Jesus, we come to thank you for your prayer, that we would be sanctified by your word, by God's truth, that we would be different, that we would be distinctly unlike the rest of the world. Lord, help us to display the radical difference it makes in being a new creation in Christ through our actions and through our love of others, through our love of you. God, this world is hard. It can be really hard. So thank you for helping us to trust in you, that we would have a joy that is not of this world. Thank you for letting us know, as your Spirit moves within us, your desire for us to be holy and to be strengthened by your Spirit to endure and overcome the evil of this world and to bring joy and goodness to others in your name. Lord, as you have sent us into this world, we ask you to now hear us pray for others who need your healing grace for their lives. Lord, hear us this morning as we pray for Sally and Kathy, for Dylan and for Jen. Lord, hear us lift to you Carol and Elaine, and Ross and Barbara. Lord, we pray to you for Joan and Chris. And we continue to pray for Joe, Margaret, and her son, and for Paula and Stephen. Lord, I lift to you those you know what's going on in their lives, as they have been brought forth to us from those in this congregation who have entered our sanctuary. Lord, we pray this morning for Bridget and Colleen. Hear our prayers. Hear our prayers for Linda and for Gemma. Lord, this morning, put your healing hands upon Laura's family and Nancy, for Sadie. Lord, we pray for Sheila and the Blairs. Lord, hear our prayers for Joni and for Tom. Lord, we lift to you Jason, Chris, and Beth. We lift to you Ron. And Lord, we give you thanks for the way that you have brought good news to Steve and Tracy. Oh, Lord God, to be holy is to lead a life dedicated to your purposes and to have that deep joy and peace in relationship with Jesus. Hear us. Hear our hearts and our minds as we silently lift up our gladness and our concerns to you, our Savior, our Sustainer, our Friend.
Thank you, Lord, for hearing us. Thank you, Lord, for giving us a sense of assurance that when you hear, you will answer as you see fit for our good and for the good of those whom we have lifted to you this morning. We do give you thanks and praise for good news, and we do continue to give you glory and honor and praise in the midst of all situations. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And would you stand as you are willing and able and join in our closing song of worship? This is Amazing Grace. The words will be on the screens.
I'm going to point out before we sing this that this is the last Sunday that we get Neil here on the drums before he goes off to college. So we had to end with something that shows him off a little bit. It's still worship, but there's nothing wrong with celebrating the talents of people in our congregation. So do be sure to thank him for his leading us in worship the last several years as our drummer as you leave this morning.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered.
the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy.
Please be seated. Reverend Becky has an announcement for you.
An announcement. I have news. So just to give you a little perspective, we've always talked about God's longing for us to listen to the Spirit and to grow spiritually, to be holy, to be emotionally happy, and to be spiritually healthy. And I have struggled with this for the last 2 years, with being healthy, spiritually healthy. I have worked full-time at hospice. I have worked here at Baker, 20 hours a week on top of it. Not such a healthy combination. And so I have gone to God for help, and God is faithful. I want to announce, Eric and I have news that I have resigned from hospice. I will be taking a full-time and fully funded position as the pastor of discipleship, care, and outreach at Kenmore United Methodist Church. Eric and I's, our last day here, will be August 29th. We'll miss you. What a blessing you've been to us. God bless you.
Now, please receive this benediction. May you go with God's Spirit living inside of you. May the face of God shine upon you, the glory of God be in you, and the work of God that has been prepared for you to do be clear in your minds, so that you may go and follow God's lead. Thanks be to God. Amen.